Okay, welcome to lecture 5 of graph theory. So today we will learn about how communication occurs in a graph. So basically we will look at three different concepts: paths, diffusion, and navigation. So how to go, for example, from one node in a graph to another node. And in particular, we will look at two different ways of formalizing this problem. So the first one is via looking at path lengths and the shortest path length. So we will try to examine different approaches to find the shortest path in a graph, and also compute the efficiency of communication or information flow in a graph. So we will look at different particular measures to quantify the efficiency of communication in a graph. And this is, you know, one way of doing it. The second way is via what we call diffusion processes on graphs. So we will look at how we can quantify the information flow in a graph, but based on what we call diffusion. Okay, so we will look at diffusion efficiency. So here, let's look at this figure. So here you guys can see we have two different graphs. So this is called graph one, okay, and we have graph two. So we have, let's imagine that we have a set of graphs, and the goal is to investigate this question. So what we want to learn is how the topological properties of graphs constrain the way in which information flows through the graph, okay? So which specific properties can be used to gain insights into information also processing or integration in a graph using its units and its nodes. For example, if this defines, this axis defines the information flow efficiency measure. So the x-axis, we plot how we quantify via a measure, particular measure, how these graphs basically are, we quantify the efficiency of these graphs. So if you look at this, which one you guys think is most efficient? Is it the first one or the second one? The second one, okay? So here you can see that this is, we have seen this in the previous lecture. So what is this called? What is this organization called? Core, it's core periphery, okay? So you have a core and you have like peripheral nodes right here, okay? So there are different types of graphs, different structures that a graph can take in, and what we want to learn is to learn how to quantify or measure their efficiency depending on how you build them, okay? So this is one of the main things, and we will look basically at these different types of graphs. There are different types of what we call the canonical graphs that define particular known structures and then try to study them and investigate their efficiency measures. Now, if we look at this one, for example, this graph, let's say we want to go from node I, okay, to node J. So how to get from node I to node J in a rapid and efficient way? So if you guys think about it, what comes to your mind? What is it that you're following? What is the rule you're following? Like, what is your strategy? How would you go about solving this problem? Given that, you know, you want to go from node I to node J, how can you get here, okay, in the most, you know, in the fastest and most efficient way? It's quite simple. Shortest path. Like, that's quite intuitive. Like, everyone would think it's, you would follow the shortest path. So I try to find, I don't know, like the shortest path, let's say, maybe goes this way, okay? And so this is what they call the path length. So it's, we try to find the path that has the shortest length. So path length basically is the criterion that we use to, you know, go from I to J, okay? So this is one way of thinking about the problem, considering path lengths. So path length and related metrics based on shortest path seem like, you know, reasonable measures of the capacity of a network or a graph to support what we call rapid integrated, and efficient communication. Now, the shortest path link, if we have a binary network or unweighted network, it can be the number of hop. It's like it's the hop count. So a hop is like, you know, if you're going, this is, for example, one hop, two, three, etc. Okay, so you're just, you know, going from one node to the other, to the next one. And if you have a weighted graph, it's quite simple. So it's the minimum, the shortest, okay, path length is the minimum sum of edge weights, okay? Now, what is the underlying assumption about information flow in a graph giving this definition? What do we assume here? What have we assumed? We assume that in this graph, okay, to go from I to J, the information will necessarily do what? Follow the shortest path. So it, like, we kind of can, we know the map, the global structure of this network, we can find the shortest path very easily, okay? But sometimes it might not be, you don't know your destination, might be not clear where you're going, okay? So knowing the shortest path might not be the easiest thing or the most efficient thing in some graphs and some real world problems. So you might, your optimal solution or your most efficient solution might not be the shortest, you know, like the shortest path basically, okay? So let's look at this. So the claim here is that signal or information propagate in real world graphs via shortest paths between graph elements or graph nodes. So this is the claim. Now, the most efficient path might not be the shortest. So this is not always true. For example, like here, let's look at this, a worm's brain. So imagine if you, like, you look at, you scan the worm's brain, you try to go to, you look at how neural signaling is happening there. And then it turns out that a worm does not have access, okay, to a map of shortest path of its own nervous system. So the key question here is, how does a neuron know that the best and cheapest way for it to send a signal to another neuron is via two-hop path mediated by a third neuron? So what does this mean? If you want to send a signal from S to T, okay, you might have many, many possible pathways. But how does this particular neuron, okay, know? How does it know that I need to go exactly through this neuron that, you know, like, or maybe through a bunch of, you know, other neurons to get here? Okay, so this is the key question, and it's actually a very strong assumption. Now, this, you know, basically the underlying assumption about the neural graph of a worm's brain is that what we say is that the routing information along the shortest path mandates that node has a global knowledge of the graph to find the appropriate path. What does it mean? So it means that basically to go from here, from S to T, I need to know all the map of the map of my brain. For a neuron to go from, you know, to find the optimal path, okay? Let's look at this one back here. So let's say this is, you know, a neural map of the brain. So for you to go from here to there, to fire a signal from, you know, like for a neuron I to fire a signal from this location to another neuron J, it actually needs to see everything and needs to know on its by itself, you know, like it needs to, each neuron needs to have its own map of all other neurons in the whole brain, basically, okay? So this is something very strong. The thing is, We might not know that. So basically, there is no up to this point there is no proof that this is true or not. Okay, but many scientists take this as a very strong assumption and try to use another alternatives to investigate how communication or how neurosignaling happens in biological systems. Okay, so here. What is the best model to use for measuring or quantifying effective information flow or communication within a graph? So we looked at shortest path, if we know where we're going and we have the map of the whole graph, so we can, you know, try to compute or identify the shortest path. Now, if we don't have that, how can we effectively, transfer or flow information through the graph structure? So there are different ways. I'm going to tell you three different stories, and the stories of three tourists here. Okay, so these present three different models or three different ways of addressing this question. So let's look at the first scenario. So in the first scenario, we have a walker tracing out a path in a graph. So let's call this walker Alice. So Alice, she wants to go from her hotel to Tokyo Tower, okay? So to go there, first Alice wants to use the shortest path possible. So, she wants to use spend less time to reach her destination. And the second thing is that how does she get to choose her next step at the intersection, knowing that she has a map, okay? So let's say here we have an intersection, okay? She starts at this location. She wants to reach her destination. And once she basically reaches an intersection right there, she's following the map. How can she know which path to choose? So here, as you guys can see, we have two options, right? So this is quite simple. If you're following the map, you can just, approximate the length and choose the shortest path, okay? So now, what is particular about this walker on this graph? So this walker, Alice, she knows where she's starting from, and she knows exactly her destination, okay? And additionally, she has a map, okay, of the whole, of the graph, okay? So here we say that Alice has a clear destination and knows the optimal route to get to her destination. So this is scenario one. Now let's look at scenario two. For the second scenario, what we have a walker who's exploring different roads, okay, in a city, for example, without any roadmap. So let's call this walker Bob. So Bob basically randomly chooses a direction whenever he arrives to an intersection. So let's say Bob starts from this location, okay, right here, and then he moves, along this path, and then when he reaches this intersection, he might go this way, and then when he reaches this intersection, he might go that way. He wants to basically go around, maybe find interesting places or along the way. But the problem is that if he keeps on doing this, he might get stuck in a cycle and get back to his destination, okay? So soon, basically, because of this random, completely randomized choice without any preferences, okay, he might end up, getting himself walking in circles, okay, which is not good. Now, to avoid this, he biases his random choices, so he is more likely to exit an intersection along the busiest or widest road. So basically, what does this mean? It means that when he starts from, okay, this is his starting point, he walks to the next node, then next stop, and then here, he's following, basically the roads with the widest, with the highest weights, okay? So instead of walking along this weak road, it's still random, right? But it's randomized and weighted by the strength of the connection here. And then right there, you have two weak connections. So he might, end up visiting Tokyo Tower if he follows this strategy. He might do so, okay? But it's not very much guaranteed, and we'll see that. So what is this, this scenario is telling us? Basically, we have a walker. He has no clear target, okay? He doesn't know where he wants to go exactly, but he has, and there is no apparent order to his journey. So he's just wondering about. Now, this is scenario two. Now, So for the third scenario, what we have another walker. Let's call her Jane. So Jane wants to actually meet Alice at the Tokyo Tower, okay? So she knows her destination, But the problem is that she doesn't basically have a map, okay? So here, she wants to get there, but does not know how to get there, which means she doesn't have a map. If you have a map, you would know, right? So to compensate for the lack of the global knowledge, which means she doesn't see all these nodes, she doesn't have access to the structure of the graph. So what she can do is basically use what we call a local information. I could have asked you, how could she operate, right? So if you're starting here, you don't know where to go, and you want to reach the Tokyo Tower right there. So basically what you can do is say, maybe move to this one and then try to collect information here locally. So you're exploring the local neighborhood and then trying to move, based on the information you're collecting locally. So that's the basic idea. So here it's like on the go, you're trying to get information about your destination, okay? So this is basically making decision based only on the information at hand, so local properties of the current location. For example, busiest road, also get information from another walker. So these are things that Jane can use to reach her destination. So up to this point, we've looked at three different scenarios. So three different walkers, they are the foundations of three big theories or concepts in graph communication. So the first one, the model one, is what we call, it's the routing via the shortest path based on global knowledge, okay? The second model, where we had Bob wondering about in a random manner, but with some preferences to when he's making his choices, this is what we call diffusing through the graph in a random way, okay? And the third model is what we call navigation to a target destination according to local information. So we have shortest path length, we have diffusion, and the third one, we have navigation. And these are three big concepts with a lot of ramification and a lot of theories. So here in this lecture, what we will look at is like the first two ones, scenario one and scenario two. So we will consider graph measures quantifying the efficiency of information flow under the shortest path routing, okay? And the diffusion also model. So for the shortest path routing, we'll look at how to find the shortest path in a graph. So we will visit one of the classical models that is very known in graph theory. And also we will look at how to compute global nodal and local efficiency using based on the shortest paths. Now, in the second part, we will learn about diffusion, information diffusion on a graph. How does it work? How to compute diffusion efficiency, okay? And even over the next, few lectures, so many lectures, we will look on how to use diffusion models to fuse graphs, also create what we call learning graph-based metrics. So the diffusion is a very powerful concept. And we will see that it's based on the Laplacian matrix, which I call is in, if we want to formalize the graph theory using linear algebra, Laplacian is the heart of it, okay? So, and then we will also look at graph embedding, and this is also connected with the concept, the shared, so there are like, you know, these basically share same concepts which are rooted also in diffusion, okay? So these are things we will look at in the next lectures.